We're back. How are you?
I'm well, thanks.
We are going to do the dope show.
I'm expectantly waiting.
Okay, good. And we haven't actually played any of the tracks to even start the discussion yet. We've talked off camera and we've talked a lot about this record and how, as a guitar player and a producer and engineer, this was one of the most exciting records. For me, probably one of my favorite records of the 90s, especially America. But then again, you have two of them.
you're too kind.
Not at all. I think with England, we were blessed with probably the Bends. And actually, I was always, you know, I just want to ask you, did you ever listen to Modern Life is Rubbish? Did you like that record?
The only things that I would listen to at that point were just like 70s records or like
nice
weird electronic music and things like that. I don't know. I didn't really keep up with anything contemporary at that point.
Right.
I didn't really like most of the rock records that people were making anyway.
Right.
That's just how it was. I didn't want to be influenced by anything.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually rejected a lot of stuff out of hand, I think.
Right.
Which worked out all right.
Worked out fantastically.
Yeah. Yeah, you know.
Well, this is the big song from the record. I mean, there was a lot of great singles on it, but this to me was the one that just jumped out of the speakers.
Yeah, I remember when I heard the demo for this, I was like, "This is going to be something."
How was the demo? What did they have? What did they put on the demo?
Well, it wasn't too far off from what you hear now in terms of structure. We had to edit it down a little bit because there were a couple of sections that went on a bit too long. But, you know, most of it was there. Pogo had created a lot of the keyboard sounds already. And I think, yeah, most of the parts were pretty much done.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to listen a little bit.
All right.
So has that got a chorus on it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, because I never really knew until we could solo it and listen to it. It always had like a drew, 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 like this like sponginess to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I couldn't tell, when I heard the bass in it, I'm like, this is spongy. I'd use that word all the time. So many people heard me say that about the bass sound, but I couldn't hear that chorusing quite like that.
That's definitely frapping out a lot than I remember.
Yeah, it might have been the bounce they did, but amazing.
Yeah, that's definitely, you can hear that. You can hear that SVT going like, right there.
Love it, absolutely love it.
Yeah.
And then this insane guitar stuff, is this back to you using synths and stuff? What is this?
Some of this was actually created beforehand.
Right.
And some of it's actually synth. That, as far as I know, that's a guitar.
Yep. I've had nightmares with that sound. I mean, it's amazing.
That's a good one. Well, all those, the synth sounds are pretty obvious on that.
Yeah.
One of my favorite drum machines of all time.
What is it?
That would be an Oberheim DMX.
That's a DMX,
and I hadn't seen one of those for years.
Right.
The last time I think I'd seen one was on Rocket, believe it or not.
Wow.
Yeah, it had been that long. I was really surprised.
It's interesting because it's like consistently inconsistent. Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's a drum machine that sounds like it's got a little bit of humanity to it. Is there?
It's an interesting way to put it.
Like every transient, you can hear it. Every transient isn't exactly like, doesn't sound like you're copying and pasting kicks and snares around and hi-hats around. It does have a little bit of breathing in it. Was there touch sensibility on it?
No.
Just compression and EQ going into it.
All them things and whatever that effect is.
Breathing a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then that
delay.
The delay on the hi-hat?
Yeah. Well, there's a delay on the kick as well.
Oh, yeah, that. Yeah. Yeah, it's fantastic. It's great.
Which is interesting, because it kind of makes it reminiscent of like some late 60s, early 70s records, the way they would like ADT them and stuff like that.
Yeah. So there's no delay on that. I'm just hearing the transient move fast. So it's with the, you're right, the delay on the kick is amazing.
Yeah. Just in some place that you would normally hear a delay.
Right. And then what's happening there to thicken up the kick? It's all, it almost sounds like it's flaming.
Wait
is it
a second,
two
where in the song is this?
I think we're in the chorus there. Show, there's lots of pretty,
pretty woman. I did that.
What did you do? What did you do?
Oh my gosh. I wanted to accentuate that a little bit more, right, to kind of pump it up. For some reason, I had it in my head to make it a little bit more kind of like a boom, da, da, doom, da, you know, kind of almost, yeah, like a stripper type beat,
right, right,
in there. Old school, obviously. Yeah, yeah. And it just, it didn't do what I wanted it to do, but it kind of ramped it up enough that it kind of, sure, it made the chorus pop a bit more. But the only reason why it would be off, I think, is because we were using antediluvian, late 1990s technology, and nothing sequenced.
Nothing quite triggered the way it was supposed to.
If it even was triggered at all, some of this stuff may have been done by hand.
Oh wow! Yes, because it's Simity.
That's about as good as we had at that point. I mean, he had some sequencers in there, but there's obviously no sequencing going on in this.
Yeah.
So, you know, anything that we would have to add over would either have to sync up via Simty, or you'd have to play it by hand and hope to God that it, you know, that it all synced up.
I wonder if that was played by hand. There's a part of me that thinks it could be.
Sure, it sounds like it. Well, that would have been yours truly.
I love it. It almost adds like a stompiness to it.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, boom, yeah.
Boom. Like a little, yeah, stomp.
Yeah. Yeah, you can hear that honk we were talking about,
yeah,
before.
The Marshall.
Hey. Oh, wow. There's a little sizzly element in there.
Yeah, there
can
is
you
something.
Hear it?
Yeah, yeah.
I think this may have been a trick, because I know I was really on the hunt to get that Ronson type, like, yeah, throaty guitar sound, and I think what I did was use that ARP 2600 surge rig, and kind of and filter that in such a way that, you know, that the right, like, resonant tones would kind, mm-hmm, of would jump out against the amplified guitar, which you can hear in there. That sound, yeah, that real nasty sound. Yep, you can totally hear the synth in that. Well, I guess I forgot that I did that.
I mean, that's what makes this, one of the reasons what makes this one of my favorite records.
I do love that guitar sound a lot,
that's
I have
a great
to say.
Guitar sound. Amazing.
He's so good, this guy.
Is that the ARP again?
I think that might be a wah. What I love about this stuff is that there's constantly shifting textures going on, It just keeps you, it keeps you riveted. Now, you know, imagine if we'd used the same guitar tones throughout, and if we hadn't really, and obviously if they didn't have someone in the band as imaginative as Pogo, like, how this, I'm sure it would have been fun, but it wouldn't have been anywhere near as, like, as engaging.
Right.
You know?
These absolutely.
These are things that just, they add, like, the magic, like, the icing to it.
Sure. You know? I agree entirely. Absolutely incredible. I mean, this is the reason why I wanted to talk to you about this song and this album.
Oh, shucks.
I mean, it is. It's for all of the variety of sound.
You know, he had his sort of conceptual overview of what this record was going to mm-hmm. be, which really pertained to a lot of the influences, like the Bowie stuff, the J.G. Ballard stuff, mm-hmm. You know, the industrial music. But my thing was something that was a little bit more general. It was this idea of it being like a cyborg.
Mm.
Remember, I think I brought that up, that it was kind of like this fusion of like a person and a machine, you know, and how to kind of like bridge the gap between those two ideas and make something that, you know, that no one had really heard before, where the tonal aspects of it were constantly shifting mm-hmm. and keeping a listener engaged.
Yeah, well, it's actually a really interesting analogy because I'd go with that entirely.
Oh, yeah. Awesome.
And then the cover imagery as well.
Oh, man. I loved it so much. Like, I just love that he had the gall to do something mm-hmm. like that. You know, I mean, obviously people were trying to be more and more outre.
Right.
But I just feel like he lapped everybody.
Oh, yeah, totally.
With that. I mean, and he disturbed so many people with that cover. People in his record company were infuriated by it.
Good.
You know, and having, I remember like driving into Manhattan and at one point and seeing this enormous billboard for the record in Times Square. And I was like, yeah.
Oh, I can
imagine. Seeing that image, yeah. Like looking out over Times Square and realizing that it was probably just freaking people out to see it. I was like, oh, this is so awesome.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, not just because I'd worked on the record, but it was like, this is like, what a statement to make. Mm-hmm. Like, what a powerful, powerful statement to make. You know, yep. Really, really shaking people up. And a lot of people couldn't handle it. You know, a lot of people really couldn't handle it. Also, it was like a profound, like, left turn away from the records that he'd done up till that point.
Yeah.
Which I really found commendable. The fact that he wanted to take a big chance by doing this record and making something that wasn't just an industrial type record.
Yeah.
You know, something that you would have expected to do something that was completely unexpected. You know, and he was the artist to do it. Like he had the brass balls to be able to just dive in and say, you know,
yeah.
I really, really have to commend him for that. You know, because I think to some extent, not to the extent that it wound up happening, that wound up taking place, I think to some extent he had to realize that he was going to alienate a lot of people who liked his records by doing this one, because it was so different.
Yeah, but it ticked all the boxes.
Yeah.
It ticked all the boxes because it was what we were talking about earlier. It's the art with the commerce.
Yeah. Yeah.
And even though there's no song that sounds like a David Bowie song, when I heard it, I was like, this guy loves David Bowie. I can hear it.
Oh, yeah.
And not just because, you know, these kind of piano sounds, let me find it again, which are very scary monsters. You know, this is the kind of thing that, you know, Trent was doing. You know, the dong, dong, that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. which is all, you know, Ashes to Ashes kind of piano song, you know, that kind of dwang, 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 dwang kind of like stuff. It's far beyond that. Like, it's not just taking little elements. It's the fact, and the cover, I think, actually feels that way to me. When you watch The Man Who Fell to Earth and you see that picture, it all makes perfect sense. Even though there's nothing, it goes beyond just oversimplifying it and calling it androgynous. I mean, that was the quick reaction that people could say.
Oh, yeah.
It went well beyond that.
Yeah. I mean,
Bowie had obviously done Androgynous, you know, 20 years beforehand.
Yeah.
This was this was really pushing,
yeah,
pushing the boundaries.
Bowie definitely invented that whole thing in the form of rock music. But yeah, what he did, it was I can't even say he took it to a whole different level, because it, in the end, I think the lack of genitals in that image was just a small part of what that represented.
Yeah.
Like the sterility.
Yeah.
It was more, I think it was more of a metaphor for the society.
Yeah, and I remember when he first came out, I thought, oh, he's kind of Alice Cooper doing industrial. That was the way I saw him initially, and forgive me. It was easy. That's the way I saw it. Okay, he's saying that, and then this record comes along, and then that makes him into a credible artist for me, because he's not just doing what we're talking about off camera, where you sort of find your niche. Somebody goes, oh, this is the thing that works. This is how I make money.
Yeah.
Bada boom, I'm gonna
do this
for the
next. And then you plateau, and that's it.
20 years of making a variation of a record. Yeah. There's so many artists, even ones that have made a couple of records we love, that do that.
Yeah.
And
he was very conscious, I think, on this record of not doing that. Like he really felt like he had to take a left turn. And to me, that really underscores a great artist. Like when you can do that and you realize that you're actually on an upward trajectory, that all your previous records have just been moving in this direction, which, you know, it stands to reason that the next record I'm going to make, unless I do my best to fudge it, is going to continue on that trajectory, to go like, okay, I can see that this trajectory can continue, but I would like to make it go this way instead of just straight ahead in that way.
Right.
You know, and do something that feels right to me instead of doing something that's going to satisfy my audience.
So when you're making a record like this, how much conversation, pre-production, I suppose, is part of the conversation, are you doing before you even get in the room?
You mean as far as talking about stuff like that conceptually?
Yeah.
I'll be honest with you. On this record, there wasn't a whole lot of it, and my own vision of this record was completely separate from his. Like what I saw this thing being, it could coexist with his image of what it was, because we were existing on two completely different planes. I mean, his idea was conceptual from a very visual standpoint, from a, just an overarching sense of what the record was, whereas mine was, how do we shape this idea that I have into my head using sound? How do we sculpt it? He's not thinking in those terms at all. He's just thinking, what's the best, you know, how am I going to evoke what I want this to be through the lyrics and through the melodies and through what my band can do now. You know, my idea was like, how do I accentuate what he's got? You know, how do I amplify that and turn it into something that I'm also seeing? That to me is the essence of the collaboration.
Yeah, I love that idea. All the pretty, pretty ones will leave you low and blow your mind.
What's interesting about some of these vocals, and you'll hear it,
mm-hmm.
is that there's some tonal variances, and that's because some of the vocals were cut with the 251. There was actually, probably still is, one particular 251 at Conway Studios, which I would always go to. I think they've got three or four of them. There's this one in particular, it's the voice of God. It's the most perfect 251 I've ever heard in my life, and I used it on all the records that I cut vocals at Conway for. But on some of the vocals that are being used here were actually flown in from his demo, because he felt that they just suited. Now in the dope show, we're all stars now. In the dope show. You can identify them because some of them sound a little bit more muted. I think they were cut with an 87.
Right. When you're not and they love another,
they love you when you're on all the covers. And again, those were cut with Sean.
And they love another. The jugs say are made in California. We love.
your face. We'd really like to sell you.
That's very Bowie to me.
Oh, yeah.
Really like to show you. Yeah, it's like.
Oh, shit.
Made
sure.
In California. We love your face. We'd really like to sell you. Yeah. Cops and queers. Make good looking models. Hate. Today, we'll wake up with tomorrow. There's lots of pretty, pretty ones. You wanna get you high. But all the pretty, pretty ones will leave you low and blow your mind.
I love his stuff so much.
Oh, amazing.
What great feel Twiggy has too.
Amazing.
It's amazing. Bass and guitar. You put the bass in the right place, pushing a little bit, and the guitar is way, way back. That really helps push the song along.
Yeah, it's amazing.
I love that.
So good. Love that.
I've thought about this a lot. Feel is one of the most important elements in music. Well, certainly in any music that's derived from folk music, from African music, which basically all popular music is. You know, feel is absolutely key to making music interesting. When music is, and I'm sure you know this, when music is too gridded and too lined up to like eighth to 16th notes, you lose all the natural feel. When you've taken a live performance of a drummer and you've basically nudged everything that person has done over so that it fits perfectly in a grid, you've essentially taken everything out of it that makes it reminiscent of being a human. Now, I mean, I don't know anyone who hasn't done some editing on their record. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You know, I've certainly had plenty of editing done on records, but the thing is that there's a fine line, and you have to know when it is you're getting ready to cross it, where you decide to keep, where you want to keep things relatively in time and start messing with the feel of how the drummer plays. You know, because that's when you actually wind up making music sound less interesting then. Mm-hmm. It's such an important dimension to music, to popular music, that gets lost so easily if we don't pay attention to it, especially when you're working with live musicians who are playing like that. You know what we were talking about before about Joe Perry, whose sound is completely recognizable, not by what amp he uses, because he sounds the same through every amp and every guitar he picks up. It's where he puts his notes. Mm-hmm. It's how he plays them. You know, you can tell John Bonham from Ziggy Modalese, not because of the fact that, like, you know, you just know a New Orleans beat versus like a straight ahead rock and roll beat. It's where they put the notes. It's where they hit the drum. You know, it's how one guy lays back. It's how one guy uses space, you know? It's, and to me, like, those signature elements they are absolutely essential parts of what make records wonderful and what makes music and this kind of music engaging.
Well, thank you ever so much.
My
I really
pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
This has been a lot of fun because I get to hear a lot of details about a truly amazing record. So
thank you.
My hat's off to you for making such a wonderful record. Go out and check it out. You probably all know it, and that's probably why you're watching anyway, but Mechanical Animals, an absolute masterpiece. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Please leave a bunch of comments and questions below. And, you know, if you've got any questions for Michael, I'll pass them on.